2023 saw just 3 IPOs instead of the target of 14, and 4 companies voluntarily delisting at the Philippine Stock Exchange. As for 2024, Citicore Renewable Energy is expected to kick off what is hopefully a stronger fundraising pipeline that may see a double in the number of IPOs. We got a chance to sit down with the Philippine Stock Exchange President Ramon Monzon for his outlook and plans this year. Here's that interview.
I would like to think it's just on a pause, okay? Waiting for the rates to go down, because obviously what's hurting the market now is the high interest rates of fixed income. I mean, I'm not sure if you're aware, based on the June 30 BSP report, we noted that, it's about 4.1 trillion pesos in time deposits. So the liquidity in the economy is there. It's just a question of rechanneling that liquidity back to the stock market, at least part of it.
And are you expecting money to flow back into equities in a big way?
We hope. We are keeping our fingers crossed. Or better yet, we're very optimistic it will.
All right.
Nowhere to go but up.
All right. I wonder, sir, what are some of the important conversations you're having about 2024?
Well, I guess the most important conversations we're having is really with the potential IPO applicants. We're telling them, you keep postponing or deferring your capital raising plans, waiting for the right market condition. I said, if you're waiting for the right market condition, that is not going to come. You have to make the market condition. I mean, if you feel your company is good enough, it will break the market condition. It could reverse the market direction. So that we've been talking to a lot of companies about this.
All right. And what's been the response, sir? How what's the mood among the companies that you speak with? What are they telling you?
A few of them, I think, are listening. One of them has already filed an application for an IPO in the first quarter. But we expect a lot of activity starting the second or third quarter, probably.
Is there a number, sir? Yeah. A number that you're targeting? How many IPOs? How much money to be raised at the stock exchange for 2024 as compared to this year?
It's a very bad year for IPOs. We only raise about 4.3 billion in the IPOs. Compared to about 21 last year. But, for the exchange, it was a good year because from zero follow-on offerings in 2022, we had about 87 billion of capital raised from preferred shares follow-on offering, primarily led by San Miguel with 34 billion, ASEAN with 25, Petron with 14, and San Miguel with 13. That's 87 billion of follow-on offerings that you might say took the place of IPOs for last year.
Why is that, course, you think, sir?
At some point, the companies realize, can't be that bad. I mean, San Miguel, their preferred shares follow-on was oversubscribed. In fact, the over-allotment, part of the over-allotment option was taken up, by savvy investors. So I think some of the companies are realizing, I think, that they have been, underestimating the power of the market. We're projecting about 4 to 5 IPOs to raise about 40 to 50 billion. But our capital raising activity will increase the forecast to about 160 to 170 from 139.
Wow, it's going to be a big jump for next year. Sir, what do you tell companies? Because there's a general thought that, in this kind of environment, many feel that this market is not ready to give the kind of valuations they think they deserve, at least not yet. What do you tell them?
Well, what I tell them is, when you do an IPO, the IPO price is not the be-all and end-all of your IPO. It's really just the beginning. I mean, if you really believe in the, the fundamentals of your company, in the, good prospects of your company, the price is going to be, I mean, you're going to be rewarded with a higher price. I mean, I keep saying, you know, I keep using A-REIT as an example. A-REIT listed at the peak of the pandemic, and it did go down from its IPO price, but now, you know, it's way above its IPO price compared to the other REITs. So sometimes you have to break the market, and, you know, you'll get amply rewarded for that.
It's never a sprint. It's a marathon for these listed companies. But are there signs, sir, that are starting to emerge on the macroeconomic side that are encouraging market participants more for 2024? It might be the BSP pause, prospects of rate cuts happening by second half of next year. I mean, some are saying we're looking at a bull market for 2024.
That's right. But everybody, you know, everybody's pinning their hopes on number one, no more increase in rates, and hopefully a reduction in rates. But another headwind would be inflation. We have to really tame inflation. So far, the forecast for next year is about 4.2, no, way below our 4%, way below our 6.2 that we forecast for 2023. So those two developments, as far as macro are concerned, well, GDP, we're projected to have the highest GDP among the ASEAN six economies at 6.2, with Vietnam following at 6. I mean, this is based on the ADB study for Asian economies. So on the macro side, that's the plus side for the Philippines. I don't know if you call it micro side, but on the other aspects of the Philippine market, you know, I'm sure you've read about the initiatives undertaken by the House of Representatives passed a bill reducing the stock transaction tax from 60 basis points to 10 basis points and reducing the dividend tax on the foreign or non-citizens, foreign individuals from 25 to 10. No, those twin moves are very powerful because what has really hurt the Philippine market, I would say, in the last several years, is our high friction costs. We're the only market that has this stock transaction tax. We have a minimum broker's commission. So addressing this friction cost, high friction cost, should put us on a level playing field with our other exchanges. And that should, you know, hopefully entice the foreign investors to come back to our market.
More on the tax reforms being passed later, sir. I wanted to ask about the delistings that we've seen. Several companies have delisted and some have decided to go private again. Has it been a very difficult call to make, these delistings? And is there a feeling they could be relisted at some point, or do you think this is a permanent move?
Well, it looks bothersome on the surface. Mm-hmm. But if you look at other markets, especially Singapore, they have more delistings than we do. Of course, they have more listed companies. So it's not a phenomenon, you might say, you know, isolated the Philippines, this delisting. Like the latest delisting we had, the Metro Pacific, they felt as a conglomerate, the discount was too high. So they delisted, but, you know, so we lost one listed company, but we expect to gain, you know, two or three from that delisting, because Metro Pacific has told us that they will be applying their toll, you know, their toll business or toll company for listing together with the Maynila, you know. So you might say it's just one step backward and two steps forward. That's the way you look at it.
All right. But it doesn't feel like the appeal of the public markets is weak. It doesn't for you, sir.
Well, no, because, I mean, there are many. I mean, what do you do? I mean, you go private. I mean, but how would you raise capital? At some point, I mean, with interest rates very high, you can't keep going to the debt market. There's still really a reason why the equities market are there. I mean, they provide you the proper gearing. They provide you the proper balance between debt and equity.